Nous allons commencer par la conférence avec ces deux professeurs, Barbara et Emmanuela. Alors, peut-être commencer par Barbara. Barbara est vétérinaire, comme la plupart des gens qui vont parler aujourd'hui d'ailleurs. C'est pour Sébastien que je dis ça, il est où ? Elle a été diplômée à l'université de Bari en Italie, dans les Pouilles, pour ceux qui connaissent, docteur de l'université de Sydney en Australie, éleveuse de chevaux, entraîneuse de trotteurs, cavalière de concours maintenant, et membre de nombreux groupes scientifiques au niveau européen dédiés au transport des animaux, ça c'est sa grande spécialité, vous l'entendrez sur ce sujet cet après-midi, et puis la protection du bien-être animal. Elle est professeure et chercheuse en sciences animales à l'université de Bologne, actuellement, en Italie. Hein, donc. Voilà, bonjour, bonjour. Emmanuela Dalla Costa, est vétérinaire également, diplômée et docteur en médecine vétérinaire à l'université de Milan, diplômée du Collège européen sur le bien-être animal et la médecine comportementale. Elle est également collaboratrice du projet européen, dont elles vont parler d'ailleurs maintenant, les indicateurs du bien-être animal, et développeuse aussi d'un protocole d'évaluation du bien-être animal, et pour les équidés principalement. Elle est professeure associée et chercheuse au département de médecine vétérinaire de l'université de Milan. Voilà, ça vous les connaissez. Puis elles vont faire une présentation en couple, oui, jusqu'à 10h15. Voilà, merci.
Merci. Ok. Can you hear me? Yes? First of all, I would like to thank Gilles and all the people organizing this nice event, because I think that is really important to share the knowledge that we as scientists have with the people that work in practice with horses. And then I would like to thank Barbara for sharing the stage with me in this first presentation. So what we are going to discuss together in this first presentation is starting from the horse evolution and behavior. We will then approach the challenges of the athlete horse and discover about training and emotion and think about needs, so behavioral needs that horses have, time budgets, and the link with possible behavioral problems. Then we will explore what is welfare, so horse welfare, how we can measure it, and the principal welfare issues that we can find in the sport horses. And finally, we will finish to talk about risk factors and horse welfare. Okay, so let's start our journey to the center of the horse. And the third thing that I would like you to raise your attention is that horses are domestic species, meaning that they have been genetically adapted over generation to live alongside humans. Domestication of horses compared to other species like dogs took place relatively recently in evolutionary time. The survival of horses is dependent on their adaptive behavior. What does it mean? That this adaptive behavior enabled them to explore a diverse range of environment to successfully rear their foals and to avoid predation. When we interact with the horse, we should always take into consideration that they are a pre-species. So their behavioral repertoire evolved in response to the challenges faced in their evolutionary niche of herd forming, they prefer to live in group, graze herbivore, so they need fiber, and they usually avoid predation by flight, so if they are scared, they fly. What does this mean? That horses are a prey species, so they evolve to respond quickly to any potential dangerous stimulus. Indeed, among domestic animals such as cows and pigs, horses have the largest amygdala, which is responsible of modulating fear response. Thus, it is clear that the process of domestication has dampened but not extinguished innate biological flight response. This is very important if you're working with horses. And you should always take into consideration that even in 2021, if a horse feels in danger or thinks to be in danger, probably it will respond flighting. So just moving away, escaping from you or from the situation. But what about horse industry? In the past, equines were vital in industry, agriculture, transport, and the military. In 1961, the estimated European horse population was about 22 million of horses. Currently, there are about 5 million of horses in Europe. The modern horse is raised for different reasons, and when compared to the past, now we have horses that are raised for companionship, leisure, and sport. And some of them are also bred for meat or milk production. What we have learned about horse behavior is that is little changed by domestication. However, in their modern life, so the horse that you are working with every day, many of the adaptive challenges have been removed. So, for example, horses that are kept in stables are protected from predation, provided with sufficient food, and sheltered from climatic extremes. But on the other hand, they are facing new challenges in their everyday life, and we should always take into account that they still have some reaction to environmental factors, and they can perceive these factors as dangerous for them. Escape behavior can be reduced with training, so we can work on this and improve the reaction of the horses, but cannot be completely eliminated. And this can sometimes lead to some accidents that frequently are considered by riders and horse owners caused by the unpredictable behavior of the horse. So now I would like you to take your cell phone, so your mobile phone, and answer to this question. So you can please go to the website slido.com. You will find a little place to put a code, and you can write as a code 998853, as you can see in the slide. And you should be able to answer to this question. You can answer in English or in French or in whatever language you prefer. Oh, 998853. Oh, okay.
It's a welcome with the capital W to Jena with the capital I.
Okay, I can see that some of you have already answered to the question. Okay. Welcome. Okay, you can see the answers coming, and it's really interesting that you identify the stress, you know, the most important challenge for an athlete horse, as well as health, and then we have some other interesting answers linked to a mental and emotional part that, in my opinion, is really important. Okay. Okay, so we can just go on. And I asked myself the same question when I was preparing this presentation, and then I tried to find the answer in the literature, and I tried to sum up what I found. I think that an athlete horse has different challenges that can be divided into two main categories that are physical challenges and then emotional one. Some example of physical challenges are fatigue. So physical conditioning plays a crucial role for an athlete, not only for horses, but also for humans. And I think that also when we are thinking about horses and riders, also riders have to do some physical preparation to be able to ride their horses at their best. It's important to train the horse gradually, taking into consideration the age of the horse, but also the physical condition, also if he has some physical issues and so is recovering from them, and give the time to the horse body to adapt to the exercise program. Every horse is different, so it's really important to personalize the training program. Another important thing is that painful condition. So painful condition is a hot issue if you work with sport and leisure horses. It is well known that athletes in general face in their life some degree of pain. Horses do not differ from human athletes in this sense, so it's important to start to recognize the first signs of pain, to try to approach the pain, understand why the pain is there, and treating the pain before make the horse working again. Because it's really important to try to avoid chronic pain, in my opinion. Another challenge that face athlete horse is training of unnatural sport specific movements. In this case, it's also important to take into consideration the age of the horse, so when we start to teach these behaviors, and also take into account the physical maturity of the single horse, so of that subject, and the mental maturity as well, so the psychological maturity, because every subject is different. Planning the training, ensuring that the horse have the physical ability to perform that behavior, that movement, and then giving the time to the horse to understand what is required, because sometimes they just need some rest to think about things, and then you ask again, maybe 2 or 3 days later, and they can perform, but they are not able to perform in that way in the specific moment when you ask them. And this is particularly important for young horses. They need some time to think about things. Linked to this concept, there are training aids and equipment. Aids and equipment should foster the communication with the horse, and they don't need to induce pain in the horse. We need to communicate with the horse, but not make them suffering for using these training aids and equipment. For those athletes involved in the international competition, we need to consider, and Barbara will speak about later on, climatic condition, travel, jet lag. If they are flying from one country to another, they need some rest, the body needs some rest, and to adapt to the new situation. I know that sometimes this can be costly, because you need to maybe to take the horse for some days in a place, but it's really needed to give the possibility to the horse to have a better performance. Okay, then we can face, so we can approach emotional challenges. We have learned from the Olympic Games that stress, as you pointed out, of being a professional athlete is enough to affect someone's mental health under, you know, the best circumstances, because Olympic athletes are in, they can train, they have just one aim in their life. I think that this can be also true for horses. You know, we raise them to compete, but they face distress, and every horse can react to distress of being competition, of being training in a different way. And also we need to take into account that for a professional horse that is working in a high competition level, they have training, but also they are traveling, they have competition, and in competition they should be really adaptable. They are moved from a place to another, they are going in crowded arenas with many unpredictable stimuli, they are moved from a stable where they know the horses to another place where they meet horses they do not know, people they do not know. And I think that more attention should be given to all these aspects. We need to prepare them to be ready to these challenges and help to cope them with these new situations. Now we can just move briefly to training and emotional state. I would like to raise your attention that when we train a horse, we indirectly induce some emotional state in the horse. This emotional state can be positive, but they can also be negative, and we should be aware of this. Negative emotional states as fear, pain, frustration, but also relief, can be associated to some sport-specific exercise or situation. Okay, so if we are in the arena, maybe the horse refuses to jump, and we then do something, and this, in doing something, we can induce some, you know, emotional reaction of the horse. And when we try to stop the flight response of the horse, so the horse maybe just won't avoid that obstacle, and we just try to stop this behavior, we link this situation, so the emotional part that the horse is experiencing with the situation. It's important when we train, trying to assure that the horse is loving what he's doing, is enjoying the training, is enjoying being with us, is enjoying the situation. Because this, in my opinion, is the first step we can take for having an happy athlete horse. If the horse loves his job, if the horse loves what he's doing, it's easier for them to improve their relationship with the competition, so the professional life of an athlete. This is a nice, a funny drawing. And what I would like you to think about is, how do you think the girl is feeling? Okay, this is training of horses. And we always need to take into account this, because horses are not machine, they have feelings, and when we train, we need to take into consideration these feelings. Okay, now just briefly, I will talk about pain. Pain is a really sensitive topic for me, and what can I say is that pain experience is subjective, and the reaction of a horse to pain is dependent upon its personality and the degree the pain is experiencing. For riding humans use some equipment, and this equipment, once again, I would like to raise your attention, is to foster the communication with the horse. However, sometimes when we use training guides, we can apply them in a harsh way, and equipment could potentially be harmful and induce pain to horses. We need to take always into consideration that the mouth of the horse is really sensitive, okay? So if we use the bit in a harsh way, we can create, induce some compression, laceration, inflammation, and all these injuries can cause both acute but also chronic pain. An interesting review has been recently published highlighting the major sites within the mouse where bit-related traumatic injuries occur and describing behavior showed by the horse with mouth pain. We need to start observing horse and understand when there is some pain involved, because maybe then we can change the equipment or change the way the rider uses the training aids. Another important aspect linked to this topic is the noseband issues. Noseband are used in equestrian sport to hold the bit in place and to reduce the mouth opening. And recent findings report that noseband determine this sustained pressure on the head of the horse and compress both soft tissues but also hard tissues and induce chronic changes in the bone of the horse. And these aspects should be carefully taken into account when we deal with athlete horses. Okay, maybe we have a horse that, I don't know, play with the mouth or the tongue, so we try to inhibit this behavior, so to prevent this behavior just by closing the mouth, but this is not a solution of this behavior. The horse is trying to telling us something. When we consider that the pain experience is subjective, we can easily understand how pain could affect training, so the response that the horse have when we are training them for sport competition, and also how this can affect the relationship that horse build with us. If we always induce pain to horses when we are training, the horse can associate that pain also with the person or with the rider, and will be not willing to work with us. Okay, so there is another question. I just need to be sure that is open. Okay. Okay, can you see the new question on your Slido? Okay. So what do you think is the most effective way to improve athlete horse performance? This is interesting.
Be biased by your slide, but
it's really interesting that you answer that positive response reinforcement can be one way for improving the performance, training as well, trust, confidence. Patient is another important thing, because we try to increase the speed for athletes that can compete younger. Okay. I think that reflecting about what an athlete horse need for being ready for competition is the first step to improve sport performance. We need to think what is needed, what we can give to the horse, and then the talent of the horse. So if they have something that come easier and something that maybe should be trained more. If we know what an athlete horse need, we can create more opportunities for its advancement, and this thing should be really we need to think about for each horse we are working with, because each horse is different. Together with the good nutrition and hydration, we know that this is really important for horse athlete, physical conditioning, health, so absence of pain and absence of injuries. We will learn later today that time to recover and sleep are also very important, so we need to foster this behavior, as well as the possibility to express some natural specific behavior. They are horses, and they need to live a horse life, not only closed in the box without the possibility to interact with anybody. Finally, I would like to drive your attention on emotional preparation, so the mental preparation. You raise this point in the first question I asked you. So you know that mental preparation, so the ability to cope with stress and to are able to cope with some stressful situation is really important, and we need to start from young horses to, let's use this term, train them to be prepared to this situation. So starting from the young age, build up the mental skills to cope with stress and adapt to the athlete's life. That is not the life that maybe the horse would choose, but if we can give them the instruments, they can then cope with the situation. And this can be the key for having a happy horse, but also a horse that can win.
So thank you for inviting me and even to Emanuela. We decided to share the presentation because we thought the 2 hours was too long. So maybe we engage you doing like that. So yeah, like backing up to Emanuela, basically, yeah, to say word horse welfare is crucial to meet their behavioral needs. But what are their behavioral needs? That's the question. So I'm sure you know what is homeostasis, and we learn homeostasis in physiology, in fluids, and we know that. But actually, there is also a behavioral homeostasis. So it's really important in a day that all the behavior are balanced out, and disruption of this daily rhythmicity, so the rhythm, the distribution of the behavior during the day, can actually affect the health and the welfare of our friends, and during this day we are going to learn about this. So what is a daily or circadian rhythm? It's basically, it's like a clock, the distribution of the behavior and the activity during the day. And just to become familiar with some difficult terms. So in a circadian rhythm, there are two phases. There are the photophase, or daylight, and the scotophase, a dark period. So what that means, basically? Horses are diurnal animals. So they have the majority of their active behavior, which I'm going to present you today, during the day. And to be ready for this activity, they actually have a peak of cortisol early in the morning. And we are also diurnal animal, maybe like not our young fellow, because they disrupt their circadian rhythms dancing all the night. But so horses are diurnal animal, and we have to consider this. And what is a time budget? So basically, it's the amount of time horses spend in their various activity during a 20-hour period. And this time budget can be affected by many factors, and season can affect it. But clearly the management has a strong effect on the time budget of the horses. So there is clearly a difference between wild and domesticated horses, but even in our domesticated horses, depending on how our husbandry practices, we are going to have an effect on this time budget. And what we really want. So if we compare, I took this and I adapted this graph from an old work of the 1999. So what is clearly in this picture? So feral horses spend almost 60% of their time budget eating. Instead, our domesticated horses tend to spend 60% of their time budget just standing and doing nothing. So as Emanuela explained, your horses have been, you know, they are grazing animals, so they are made for actually eat small amount of food and cover 60% of their day. And that's something that we always should remember when we manage horses, because that's clearly one of their behavioral needs. And as I said, like, you know, what we really want when we manage horses and they try to respect their behavioral need as much as we can. So, and this is why, like, you know, now I'm actually trying to refresh you, what are those behavioral needs, and then basically how we actually divide the behavior. The two main categories are active behavior and inactive behavior. Among active behavior, we have the feeding behavior, social behavior, and locomotory behavior. And feeding behavior, so remember that at least 55% of the time budget should be spent in feeding, and how we can actually manage this. Clearly we need hay, pasture. That is the key to have to reach this at least 55%. It's clearly like when we feed horses, like we have two habits just to think about the nutritional requirement. We are all good, you know, with the softer, and we can do the perfect diet, but we forgot about the timing that the horse need to chew the diets. So that's something that's a thing for thought, I think. And then explorative behavior. So horses are curious animals, you know, but and that's a need. They need to explore the environment. Just give them time to explore. Like even this afternoon, I'm going to speak to you about the transport. Just, yeah, give them 2 minutes to explore the ramp. Like, you know, it's their need. They need to know where they are going, like, you know. And so, and that's really important. And also, as Emanuela said before, they are social animals. So they herd animals. So it's really important that, like, you know, we give the opportunity to meet this behavioral need while we manage them. Because when those needs are not met, the horse may react with signs of apathy, boredom, weakness, reactivity, and abnormal stereotypy, which we are also going to listen and learn about. And grooming. So they are social animals, and they need a lot of grooming, also because with grooming, they form, but they also bond relationships. So if we never let our horses groom with other horses, just try to spend your time grooming the horse. I've done a study on T-touch, and actually at least try to, like, you know, kind of substitute this absence of allo grooming with other horses, at least with you. That might strengthen your relationship with your horses. And playing. So playing optimizes the coordination of movements and the first approach to social behavior. So it's really crucial for foals. So they really need to play with objects, play with other animals, but even adult animals, like, you know, they still, clearly, it's less time in their time budget, but still induce positive emotion. And now, like, with EFSA, we are all obsessed by playing, trying to understand how we should manage animals to let them play. And locomotory behavior. So, as I said, they are grazing animals, and they basically build for walk around and graze and look for food, for water. And the locomotion, so it's really important. And that's the other issue. So our domesticated horses are really limited in movement. And So motor activity, both in horses allocated in a single box and horses allocated in a paddock, has been studied by some colleagues from Sicily. And we are back to the diurnal animal. So since they are diurnal animal, it doesn't matter if they live in a box or on pasture, they tend to move more during the day. And this is why, like, you know, I raise you this question, because from the welfare point of view, we like, organize competition at night because of the thermal stress. We move horses at night. It's actually mandatory. But no one has actually studied the effect of transport at night on actually the disruption of possible sleeping partners. And that is, again, some food for thought. I'm sure that Catherine can back up me in her presentation. And while I was younger, I've been a crazy standardbred owner and trainer, so I was obsessed by exercise. So what we did, I wanted to study the effect of the different type of training. So you're just a normal daily training, like, you know, I'm sure 40, 55 minutes standard trot, slow trot. Then the fast exercise, so the simulation of the race and the race. So I studied the effect of these three type of exercise on physiological and behavioral parameters. And clearly, all of them had an effect. They increased the heart rate. But what was really amazing for me is actually the same physical effort, like, you know, same training, speed training, like, you know, exact seconds per mile, had less effect than the competition, the real race. And that's come back to what Emanuela told you before. Competition is not only physical effort, it's also emotional effort for the animal. And actually, yeah, before the racing and after the training, after the racing, their behavior was different, was statistically different. So, and this is why we have to consider that when we plan resting time. This is not only, you know, exercise, sweating, okay, so the heart rate is back, but try to think about all the emotion that the animal related with the competition, because they know the racing day. So they know, and they advert even like 6 hours before actually the real race. And about the inactive behavior, like, you know, we are going to have a presentation on Catherine, so, and they are sleeping and resting behavior, and as I said, they are usually concentrated in the dark period of the day. And we are in a area of sensors, so there are lots of smart technologies nowadays which could help us to monitor the physiology and the behavior of our horses to try to improve actually how we manage them. And so I tried to summarize what is now in the market, and I think that, like, you know, we should start become more technological when we race horses or we manage horses. So I'm sure you are all familiar with the heart rate monitors. I'm sure that all of you have Polar and fancy thing. And we know about the heart rate and the heart rate variability, so the speed of the heart rate change, and then the GPS. So, but we use this mainly just for training purpose. So, like, you know, we want to know how much our animal, like, you know, has, you know, the heart rate, the speed, all these parameters. But we could actually use those fancy instruments also to monitor their health and behavior in the rest of the day. Because what is a main issue right now? That we think of horses only during the training, and we forget about it 23 hours when we don't train them. So, and like, you know, those monitors, they could be really useful also, like, to alert you if the horse is starting feeling pain, because, like, you know, also pain raise heart rate, for instance. So they could be alert you for colic or other possible situation. Then we have a wearable electroencephalogram, which study the brain activity, and they are used mainly for sleeping partners or research. Then there is this EquiWatch system, and it's nice because actually it records the chewing behavior, and again has been used mainly for research. But again, like, you know, when a horse stops eating, that will be probably the first sign of some pain or possible colic. So again, it could be an alert system really useful. Then we have rectal temperature and environmental T sensor. We really want that our horses are managing their thermal comfort. So there are some sensors that you actually can put under the rug to understand if actually they are hot under the rug. Or, like, you know, there are some sensors that you can stick under the tail and monitor the rectal temperature during long journey. So you can actually make an early diagnosis of shipping fever using these tools. And that's a really fancy, but at least we could actually use video cameras. So, like, you know, to monitor the behavior of our horses, keep an eye on them. Or even better now with machine learning. So we're trying to develop some machine so that they can recognize the behavior of the horses, so that actually we even don't need to look at the camera, because we are lazy now, so we don't want to do even that. But so then the camera is so smart that they can recognize the behavior of the abnormal behavior of the horse and send you a text. Maybe that could be a way how to go. And back to this behavioral problem to Manu.
Okay, so let's see. As you probably know, horses can develop some behavioral problems. And I think that these are really important, not only for horses because they suffer, but also for people because they can create some accident. And for safety of people is really important. Problems with horse behavior are an everyday occurrence. They are quite common. And I was really surprised when I read this paper by this colleague, because 91% of leisure riding horses in the United Kingdom exhibited some unwanted behaviors on a regular basis, meaning that the rider go to the stable and every day need to fight with the behavior of the horse. And of course, from the human point of view, this can be frustrating, but from the horse point of view, I mean, there is an issue that cannot be solved. Unwanted behavior can take many forms, so they can be really different. We have some normal equine behavior that the owner cannot cope with. For example, if they are destructive in the stable, or they paw, or they just destroy the environment. Some others are learned behavior. What does it mean? That we indirectly train the horse to behave badly, but we are not able to do the opposite, so to train them to do something that we like. And some others are behavior indicative on something that is wrong in the horse, so some pain or some other physical issues. A variety of unwanted behavior are reported by horse owners. Some of them are associated with aggression, so aggressive behavior. And this aggressive behavior can be to other horses, but also towards human, fear and phobias that are really common and then can be really dangerous also for people, sexual and maternal behavioral problems, and this is important if you are breeding horses. If you have a mare that do not want the foal or has some problem, we really need to consider this when we decide to reproduce her.
Stereotypes, performance problem as well are really important because sometimes the horse is doing well in training and then at one point he start to behaving badly, so he refuses the obstacles, he start bucking, he start doing something strange for the rider. We need to consider this behavior, not addressing the horse as a culprit, but trying to understand why the behavior has changed. Then we can have abnormal eating habits and undesirable stall behavior, meaning that maybe when you go with the feeding time, the horse starts spawing or kicking or is aggressive towards other horses. All this unwanted behavior or problematic behavior can have a significant impact on performance of horses because it spends some of the hours doing this behavior that are not useful, you know, for the performance that the horse then have. So for this reason, if you have a problem with the horse, you need to try to understand why and try to solve. Because if you try to so if you do something, maybe the horse can decrease his stress and live more relaxed in his environment.
Te la faccio solo partire. So now another question for you. So
okay.
So wake up, take your phone and reply to this question.
Okay.
So can you give us an example of a horse welfare issue now? So we look it up at the challenge before, and now it's actually issue. Welfare issues. Vado avanti. Quando fai click, va avanti. Pain that's induced by you. Barefoot racing. Chronic pain, kicking. No pasture. Give you more time to think. We have only 19 people. Okay, so these are your answers. So aggressivity, chronic pain, single staving. So trying to summarize what actually we know from the literature, and these are the most common welfare issues. So unwanted horses, abusive training methods, horse loggia, long distance transportation, single box, as some of you pointed out, injuries, doping is still a welfare issue, carriage, horse welfare. And this is what actually, like, you know, comes from the literature, from studies, and clearly some of these affect top athletes and some others clearly don't. So, but what is welfare for you? So, because, you know, what is usually easy point our finger on a welfare issues, you know? Like, you know, you say, okay, well, that's all, like, my neighbor horse suffer from pain, or my neighbor horse do not have pasture, and so then we call, because it's always the neighbor. But what is welfare? What is welfare for you? Can I have a couple of answers from the audience? Now, Gilles, he knows the reply, so. Yeah, what is welfare for you? I'm pointing at you.
Le bien-être pour moi, pour un chat, c'est quelque chose de très individuel parce que je pense qu'il faut tenir compte de sa personnalité pour pouvoir lui apporter ce qu'il a besoin. Parce que par exemple, si on prend la détention,
It's a long definition of welfare. I didn't really get it because I cannot speak French, but like, you know, basically what often come up when, like, you know, it's that the definition of welfare might change depending on the context. So, like, you know, veterinarian, for instance, tends to associate welfare with health, and some other people have a different definition of welfare. So, basically, this is why I thought that maybe we should learn what welfare is in a convention like that. So one of the first definition of welfare by Broome is the welfare of animal is its state as regards its attempt to cope with its environment. And Emanuela was explaining you the, how important is cope with stress. But Duncan, 6 years after, said neither health, sorry for the vet, no lack of stress, no fitness is necessary and or sufficient to conclude that an animal had good welfare. Welfare is depends upon what animal feels, so back to the emotion of before. And recently, John Webster said, feeling fit and happy, but what is a happy horse? So it's actually difficult to define what welfare is, and also because it's a combination of good physical fitness, good mental health, and living well. So all the behavioral needs which I was speaking you before. So basically, we are here with a good welfare. And so what is animal welfare? We are animal welfare scientists. So actually, I like this definition. Welfare is a term that describes a potentially measurable quality of a living animal at a particular time and a scientific concept. So what I wanted to point that horses, our friends, should have a life worth living. So, but how actually we can measure welfare? We need to measure welfare from their eyes. So we should stop to assume what the horse like depending on what we like. So we stop, try to do this, and actually taking data from the horses, from the eye of the horses. And this is why now, as a welfare scientist, we tend to measure welfare using animal-based measure. So data that come from the animal. And I want to, this is also an important message to me. The welfare needs of an animal are the same regardless of its category. So it doesn't matter if it's a draft horse living on pasture or my top athlete, jumping athlete, their needs, the horse need, are the same. And that's another question for you. So, and I wanted now raising your hands because the internet allow us only 3 questions. So, look at this picture. Is this good welfare? Yes, no, or I don't know. Who is for yes? Okay. Who is for no? Okay. Who doesn't know? Okay, we have some. Okay. What about this? Is this good welfare? Who thinks that is a good welfare? Who thinks it's no? They are meat horses. Their horse is bred for meat. Is it good welfare? So no? Who doesn't know? Okay. What about this? We are all familiar with this. Is this is this good welfare? Yes? Only one. Who is for no? 1, 2, 3, 4. Who is for 6? Who is, I don't know? Sorry, but I tricked you because what I said before, we cannot actually judge from actually welfare just from a picture. And sorry, but that was my message. So try to stop assuming the welfare status of an animal from a picture or just passing by a stable, because really we need to measure the welfare status of the animal. And today, like, you know, during this presentation, we're trying to explain you how. Back to Manu.
Okay. So how we can measure animal welfare? Starting from the definition that already Barbara talked to you, described to you, we can potentially measure welfare. But we need to take into consideration, as Barbara said before, that welfare is multidimensional. So it's not one thing. So it's not the pasture, it's not just the stable or what we give the horse to eat. So we need to take into consideration several parameters. And it's really important that we do not use one measure alone, because we miss some part of the pictures. Okay. Welfare assessment tool must involve some measure that can be measured at the same time, so we have an overall picture of the horse of the horse life. And it's important that these measures are valid and reliable. And from a practical point of view, it's also important that they are easily operated by trained people. So we have different people that can measure, or they can take measure in the same way. Otherwise, maybe I'm able to evaluate the welfare of horses, but she's not, or the opposite, and we cannot talk the same language. And this is really important, I think, not only between scientists, but also between scientists and people that working with horses, because for me, the crucial aspect is that the people, so you that are working with horses every day, understand why welfare is important, because you can make the difference. We can study, but you can make the difference for the horses. So we have two different category of measures. As already Barbara said, we have indirect measures that are resource-based or management-based measure that can be linked with the environment. So for example, resource-based, we can ask about food, water, and lying space or bedding or whatever we give to the horse. And for management-based, we can ask about feeding practices, housing system, training methods. We can ask, or we can look, you know, when the horse are trained or feed and housed. But then we have direct measures, so something that we can look on the horse. And this is these are really, really, really important, because we need to come back to look at the animal and not only look at the environment. So we have behavior, but we also have physiological measure that we can measure. Now we have the sensors that enable us to monitor the horse throughout the day, so not only when they are trained, but also when they are in the stable. Health parameters, so if the horse is not healthy, we need to intervene and do something. And also for those of the animals that are kept for production, we have also some production measure that can be assessed. There are different approaches to measure horse welfare and animal welfare in general. I think that we started from the five freedoms, so the basic needs of the horse. Then we go to the principle and criteria developed by the welfare quality, and then we have these five domains model on animal welfare. And I think that in the next few years we will have maybe other approaches. The most important thing that I would like you to raise your attention is that welfare is not one number, okay? There are many things that we need to take into account, because if you think about your welfare, so the welfare in your life, maybe you are stressed from work, but you have a nice family, so you can compensate. So it's really important that we take into account all these aspects to understand if that horse in that particular time is in a welfare situation.
So, and quickly today, we, like, you know, going back to the Awen method, the welfare quality method. So we have, like, you know, the four principles, and for each principle there are some criteria and some animal-based indicator or measure. So basically, good feeding is clearly an important welfare principle, and the criteria are appropriate nutrition and absence of prolonged thirst. So how actually, what are the indicators? So for appropriate nutrition, we can use the body condition score, which I'm sure you know about. So how we actually measure body condition score. And again, it's something that you should learn if you cannot do that. Maybe, Gilles, you can organize a training if you have not already done. So it's important because it's not only visual. For horses, you really need to touch the horse because you have to learn the difference between muscle and fat. And so basically these are the area where you have to look at the horses and touch the horses, and then basically you can decide what is the body condition score of the horses, and it's a scale from 1 to 5, and the optimum is actually around 3. So, and the extreme, so the one, a cachectic horses, I guess we all think that is a welfare issue, but what about this? So 5. So we are actually in a area where obesity is a welfare issue. So we tend to feed our horses too much, but obesity, it's actually a real problem because really, like, you know, can affect thermoregulation, and our horses compete, they need to thermoregulate because otherwise they get problems or breeding problems. So fat is not a friend of vitamin E, so, like, you know, that otherwise we are going to struggle to have babies from our super fatty mares. Joint stress, like, it's normal, like, you know, I also gained 10 kilograms due to the COVID lockdown, and, like, you know, now I'm struggling doing steps. Before I was much more lighter and I had no, like, you know, joint pain. And clearly intolerance to exercise, because, you know, if I'm heavy and, like, you know, I feel all the pressure on my joint and I cannot thermoregulate, it's normal that at some point I hate exercising, like, you know, I want to be on my couch drinking beer. So that is what also your horses, I don't know about the beer, but, you know, doing. And going back to serious obesity, it's really linked to, associated with metabolic syndrome and laminitis. So, like, you know, it's really, really important that we monitor the body condition score and we start thinking that an obese horse is not a happy horse. What about thirst? So, absence of prolonged thirst, we have water availability and then the bucket test. So, I'm sure that all our horses have, like, you know, modern water point. The only thing that we have to consider, that they are really nice, but often we don't really know how much our horses are drinking. So now there are some sensors that you can put on the water point, telling you the exact quantity that the horse is drinking. And, you know, I think in Switzerland it's really cold, so maybe you can struggle with ice. So now there are actually better water points where you don't have only cold water but also warm water, so you can actually avoid this problem. And clearly, like, you know, the water needs to be available, but the water point needs to be clean. And I'm sure that you have some nasty horses pooing in the water point, so try to check every day, because sometimes they don't do on purpose, but, you know, it can happen. So try to go and clean the water point every day, or even twice a day when you clean the box. But how much water they need, I'm sure they know this, just to remember that. Just a normal horse, 500 kilogram horses, in a maintenance level, needs 30 liters of water. Clearly, the need of water reduce if they are on pasture, because, like, you know, grass has lots of quantity of water inside. But remember, the exercise almost double the need. and the heat, and we are going in the water warming global situation. Every summer is always hotter. So really try to remember that heat and exercise really increase this number of like a lot, double or triple the number. So and actually, how can we measure if our horses are thirsty or not? There's a bucket test. Like basically, you could try to offer fresh water with a bucket and see the time that the horse takes, so the latency time to approach the bucket or how much he drinks. That is considered a feasible, easy measure. I like the capillary filling time as a vet, and which I think it's a valid indicator of dehydration. So like, you know, but clearly dehydration and bee thirst are slightly different concept. So, and again, about good feeding, as I said before, so we want to cover the need. A body condition score is actually telling just if the diet is correct, is not too low, not too high. But remember also about the timing that the horse need to spend feeding. And again, some of you said lack of fiber, yes. In good feeding, we have to consider that forage should be at least 60% of a diet. But like, you know, if the horses are not really competing too much, like, you know, they are not really in intense training, maybe we can even raise this proportion and increase the quantity of forage and hay for, as I said, make them spend more time feeding and avoid obesity. Back to Manu with a good housing.
Okay. So about good housing, the animal is free from physical and thermal discomfort. So we need to ensure that he has a shelter that can keep him protected from elements and the comfortable resting area that is really important for resting and sleep. So good housing has three different criteria that are comfort around resting, thermal comfort, and ease of movement. This is another important topic. As you know, method of housing can really differ in different countries, and often they are based on convenience, so the place where you are and you have the horses, and traditional practice when we think about horses that are kept for a sport. As you already know, the housing system can affect and greatly influence the welfare of horses and affect also the behavior they can show. As Barbara said before, if they have pasture and they can graze, they will move more and they will graze. If they are kept in single boxes, they just still stand still, so they are staying there. So we need to consider the need of the horse and balance the time that they can stay in single box and time that can stay outside the box. Horses are really frequently housed in individual boxes. The owner perceives that they can protect the horse better and they can control the horse better if they are in the box. However, in single boxes, the horse are confined. So they are closed in this box and they cannot go outside. And although they prove to be able to cope with this situation, there is an increasing awareness among scientists that this can affect horse behavior and welfare. But why confinement is so detrimental for a social species such as horses?
confinement prevents from satisfying highly motivated behavior, such as social interaction. They cannot freely interact with other horses. And we decide, you know, the neighbor of our horse. They cannot decide to stay near Barbara or near other friends. They cannot move freely, so they cannot decide when to exit and go for a walk, or when they want to stay inside and rest. And the other important thing is that this can lead to boredom, because they don't have anything to do, and to insecurity. If they are scared about something in the environment, they cannot escape, because they are closing there. And we all experienced this during the quarantine period, during the COVID pandemic, and I think that we all experienced this increasing frustration of important needs. We would like to go outside, to see friends, to go outside for dinner, and we have faced this unpredictability of the situation, because it was the first time for all of us, and this is linked with an increased fear and anxiety. We were anxious because we don't know. And for the horse, is more or less the same. This situation, we know that caused increased mental issues in people and affect also different age in different ways. So it seems that was more important for young people, because is an age that is really important for social development. And I think that for horses is more or less the same. We can cope with a stressful situation for a short period. Then we have differences in coping ability that differ from one individual to another. But we need to take into account that this confinement is stressful for horses. So, what about free exercise? Why we do not put our horses outside? What is described in the literature is that owners fear that the horse will become agitated and injure themselves when put in paddocks. And of course, if we are thinking about a sport horse, they can impair their performance if released in paddock, maybe because they are tired, or this is what the owner thinks. Another thing that I was really surprised is that they think that 1 hour spent daily at work is enough to meet the needs of locomotory behavior. And if we think, and if we remember what Barbara presented before, I mean, the horse spend most of the time of their day just walking around. So it's not 1 hour in the paddock that can meet this need. This recent publication showed that even horses that never experienced free movement, so they were stable only in single box for all their life, they can cope to be outside, and they habituated rapidly to the situation. I think that this can be improved, and the author suggested this, if you use hay or if you have grass in the paddock, can reduce the behavior that we do not want, so the jumping, running, that can be dangerous for the horse. So if you just put some hay, they are distracted for the first minutes, and then they just maybe explore the environment without having this behavior that we fear. And another interesting point of this paper was that horse welfare improved during the paddock release. In particular, they reduced the stereotypic behavior, so those of them that presented some stereotypes decreased these stereotypes, and the oxytocin level increased, so they were happy to be outside. Because, as Barbara said before, is not only to be closed, but if they can go outside, they can explore, they can see the sun, they can see something happening. So is like for us, maybe watch the television. They can do something else that is not staying on the sofa looking at the
nothing.
At the wall.
Staring at nothing.
Okay, just very briefly, because then Catherine will speak. I would like to raise your attention about sleep in terms of what we give to the horse for sleeping. The box is important, the litter is important, they need enough space to lie down, otherwise they cannot sleep properly. And we all experience this when we change our bed and the bed is not comfortable. You, in the morning, you are not so ready to start the day. So for the horses, is the same. It's really important sleep, and for sport horses is really crucial in my opinion. So we really need to ensure. Sometimes we go to in some stables, you have big show jumping horses, very big, in a small box because the box are more or less fixed for the measure. And what I think is always, they can lie down and sleep properly. And we need to think about this to be sure that we give the best situation to them for sleeping and resting.
So the other welfare principle is good health, and one of the criteria is absence of injury. And clearly, so it's really important that every day you check the horses. I suggest you always a visual inspection. I'm sure that clearly all of us is able to recognize a fresh bleeding injury, and I mean, like, you know, and we know that we need to call the vet when something like that. But like, you know, sometimes we could kind of give less importance to coat or high condition, but still something which is related to absence of injuries. And that's also another point, chronic injuries. So like, you know, how many of our horses have really nice legs and nice joints? And if we have considered that chronic injuries are still injury, and to have good welfare, we want absence of injury. And then clearly lameness. So I'm sure that we are familiar with the scoring. So the lameness score is an ABM, so an animal-based indicator. And clearly, like, you know, if we want to have a good welfare, we should have zero lameness. So absence of lameness is a criteria. We also want absence of disease, and so this is why it's important that our horses are routinely checked, and we should also look for a subclinical disease which can impair anyway our performance. I'm sure the Gilles today is going to tell us more about it. And I stress this correct diagnosis, misdiagnosis, delayed diagnosis also impair welfare, because when as a vet I'm wrong, or as an owner I do not call the vet straight away, or like, you know, I don't let the vet do all the diagnostic tests, I'm actually increasing a period of sufferance. And so please really remember that good welfare means also early and correct diagnosis. And absence of pain. So that is the definition of pain. And so defines pain as an unpleasant sensory and an emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissues damage, or described in terms of such damage. And again, come back with homeostasis. Pain is a homeostatic mechanism that is not homogeneous, but represents a continuum of varied physiological and behavioral responses that are unique to each animal. So I'm sure you are familiar. Actually, studying pain is difficult because each animal might have a different pain threshold. So we have, and I think if you are a you know, like they've been winning horses. They were completely like, you know, maybe lame outside the racetrack. They compete and they're perfect. But why? Because they really have a high threshold for pain. They can cope with pain. Or others, though, are drama queen. You know, so like, you know, little thing, one hair is moved and they are completely in pain. So, but like, you know, each animal is different. So you should try to understand what is the threshold of your horse, but also try to respect those horses with a big heart, which have also a high threshold for pain, not to push too hard, knowing that he can cough 2 minutes for racing, he will be fine, he will be win again today. And the heart for pain is actually, there is no standard in both human and non-human animals. So this is why measure pain is hard. There are composite pain score where we combine behavior with physiological parameter, and also some of you are vet, you know, you have to touch the horses very painful. So composite pain score could be dangerous also for the tester, because, you know, clearly if you, the horse has a pain on a leg and you push on a leg, then, you know, it could react, it's normal. And this is why, like, you know, now we are trying to look for new biomarkers, so something which is less invasive. And there is a salivary alpha amylase or the horse grimace scale. So I try to understand pain just by facial expression. Now there are even new technologies which are machine learning for facial recognition, because the problem when the I think the first horse grimace scale paper went out, that everyone was staring at the horses in the paddock trying to understand, and the horse was staring back, changing all their facial expression. So clearly it's important that you don't really interact too much if you want to try to learn how to score pain using facial expression. So again, try to use cameras. And health, clearly, what is health? So health is the state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And that's something that we also forget. So even health is not only lack of disease. So it's something more. And again, like, you know, this was a nice paper published from the group on Wren, and they actually they realized that even looking at the horses, they might have different posture inside the box, depending if they are kind of depressed. So we have this withdrawn posture that are basically like with this straight line, and that was associated with a kind of depression for horses. And how do we assess mental health? So that's actually tricky and difficult. So I have to say that we are really good at measuring negative emotions. So we, for the last 20, 30 years, we associate kind of good welfare with lack of negative emotion. And we almost good at that, but again, we need something more. So I guess, like, you know, we should look for positive emotion and indicator of a positive welfare. So not only looking and measure the ethogram of stress or pain and stuff like that. And how actually we can do this, we are still, I think, try to study this area, but, like, you know, we know that serotonin, oxytocin are a good biomarker for positive emotion right now. There is this other brain-derived neurotropic factor, and what we are trying to do is trying clearly to validate those biomarkers and associate those biomarkers with behavior, because the problem is that, you know, even to assess oxytocin, I need to take blood, and that we might induce pain, is too invasive. So some of our studies trying to see if some behavior is strongly associated with this, so that, like, you know, if when I see that behavior, I know that the level of oxytocin is high. I don't know if I've been clear. And back.
So the last criteria is appropriate behavior. We talk about appropriate behavior a lot today. We need to ensure that the animal is able to express its normal behavioral pattern. So think about the species in itself. And to show this kind of behavior, it needs to have sufficient space, proper facility, and the company of other animals. Another important aspect of this principle is about the emotional part. So we need to ensure that the horse is not in fear or distress, because the condition we give them should prevent this mental stress, mental suffering. So what about social behavior? This was a study I did when I was doing the PhD. So I went to assess the welfare of horses in different stables in Italy and Germany. And what we found, we visited 40 stables, and what we found was that 22% of horses of our sample did not have any possibility to even see other horses. So they just in the box. The box was looking the wall, and that's it. And another 39% could only see other horses. So, for example, the horse in the corridor. And if we take into consideration all these results were related to sport and leisure horses, so horses kept for work. In a sense, some of them for companionship or leisure riding, some of them were competing. And when we take into consideration all these results together, it's easier to understand that more or less the 60% of these horses have really low possibility to interact or no possibility to interact with other horses. And this restriction has an important impact on welfare of horses. It has been demonstrated that when kept in groups, young horses adapt more easily to initial training. So the possibility to spend the time with conspecific can help us in training horses because their stress level is lower. And linked to this, they develop less unwanted behavior or problematic behavior because they can freely express themselves. And another important aspect is while all the adult riding stable horses were kept in group for some time during the day, they were less prone to react, and you can reduce the accident. So even if you're working with children, so kids, school riding horses, that maybe is not your situation, but you can have a horse that is less stressed and so is more prone to work with them as well, less reactive. We cannot talk about horse welfare without mentioning stereotypies. We will go in depth this afternoon. Stereotypies are quite common in horses, I just want to underline that we have evidence that social isolation can play a role in the development of this behavior. So, especially for young horses, winning time and start of the training is really important to give them the possibility to stay with other horses and to behave like a horse. Because the other point important is that once stereotypic behavior is established, it's really, really difficult to stop it or to change this behavior, even if we change the environment. And I think that you know this problem, and this problem can really affect the level of welfare of dead horses. Finally, we just mentioned about human-horse relationship.
Human horse relationship is the relationship that we can build with our horses, and we have just pointed out that sport horses often are prevented from have social interaction with conspecifics, so they can really bond with us. And the relationship with human is really important also in sport horses, because then if they have a good relationship with the rider, they perform well. Horses can associate the interaction with humans, as we already said, with negative emotion, because we can induce fear, but we can also induce pain, and this can be linked to training or riding, and they can associate this. For this reason, they can become anxious around people, and they can become reactive when have people around, and this can be a safety issue. Okay, horses can be dangerous if they react. This can lead to accident, and we know that a high percentage of riders or horse owners will experience some sort of injuries linked with interacting with horses during their life. For this reason, we need to foster the development and the maintenance of a good relationship with our horses. And as Barbara said before, we need to look at the picture with the horse eye, so we need to give them what they need, try not to so what they perceive as positive, try not to training them with harsh method that can impact on the relationship we build up with them, and just remember that the horse learn from when they are foals, but they learn throughout all their life. So if you have an old horse, he can also learn about you, and you can and he can learn to trust you. So it's really important to handle them properly. As a final remark, we will discuss about positive emotional state. That is one of the biggest challenges in animal welfare science, and the colleagues that are there, they know very well that it's really, really difficult to measure positive emotional state. We used the qualitative behavior assessment method to evaluate the expressive quality of animal behavior and emotion. This method relies on the ability of humans to integrate the observed details. So we look at the horse, how it moves, how it interacts with the environment, and we try to understand what it's feeling. It's difficult, but I think that we need to do a step forward to try to understand if the horse is happy also during training. I really like this this approach that take Faye about the happy athlete, because I think that now is really important to promoting positive emotional state in horses and giving them the possibility to be happy.
So to close, like, you know, I think we understood that major welfare is complex and it's multidimensional. So what now the EFSA is doing, EFSA it's the European Food Safety Authority, but we are, there is a panel just on health and welfare and includes also horses, is trying to have evidence, so do a scientific approach to welfare, and also like do risk assessment. So basically try to identify welfare consequence. So basically, for instance, frustration of exploratory motivation, and then identify statistically some risk factor like lack of enrichment, and then basically also tell to the people how to recognize if actually the animal are suffering from that particular welfare consequence, so looking at animal-based measure. So and when we have this easy association. So we have a problem, we know what is the cause, and we know how to measure or identify if the horse has a problem, then we can do preventive and corrective measure. So, and that's, I think, it's also a good approach that we should start be familiar with, because, as I said, like, you know, it could be that welfare is a complex and multidimensional. So, like, you know, if we really have maybe only one welfare consequence, then maybe with this approach we can easily understand what is the problem, what is the factors which induce my lameness, for instance, and then, like, you know, so I can correct the thing, or even better, I can do preventive measures so that, like, my horses do not actually have lameness in their life. And with this, we thank you for listening, and again for the invitation. Thank you.
Question?
Ah, okay.
Oui, oui, j'ai parlé dedans. Est-ce qu'il y a une autre question? Oui, je sais. Non, on parlait. Bon, ça ne semble pas être le cas. On va vite voir si elle trouve quelque chose. Ça, vous ne voulez pas la poser comme ça, la question? Ok, je vous donne le micro.
So, thank you very much for your presentation. The first question that I had is regarding if you observe any difference between the behavior between horses on straw or shaving.
Difference in behavior?
Bedding. Bedding between the straw and shaving.
It seems that if the horse can choose, he prefers to stay on straw. Okay, so it seems that it's better. It seems that they prefer that because they can nipple, but it is also more comfortable when they can rest, so lying down. Always you need to take into account, you know, the quantity that you put inside, and also how the box is structured, because it's really important that it's not wet or dirty, so they cannot lie properly.
Thank you. And I have a second one, which is, do you know if there is any available AI program to monitor the sleep of a horse?
This is for you.
Yeah, I think Professor Habt has a talk, like, you know, this afternoon about sleeping, and I think the effect
this morning.
Okay. So.
Okay, thank you.